Good morning. Welcome to church. It's so great to be gathered together. Let's stand as we sing this first song that is one we haven't sang in a while, but let's sing it.
Password to his presence, we give thanks. To face all disappointment, fills a house with holy moments, we give thanks.
Gathered together as we sing that there's nothing better than Christ, and all that we have and all that we need is found in Him.
Reaching out to welcome you, God. Harvest family. We get to celebrate the victory of our Lord Jesus Christ and the miracle of salvation today with some baptism. It's going to be awesome. So guys, this is Ethan Tanassi. Ethan, man, can you tell us how you came to know Jesus as your Lord and Savior?
Absolutely. So I was born and raised in a Christian family. And as I got older, I decided to pick up the Word of God and read Ephesians chapter 2, verses 8 through 9. And it said that we are saved through grace and faith in Jesus. And then ever since then, I decided to give my life.
That's right. That's awesome, man. Yeah, praise the Lord. Yep. So since then, how has Jesus been working in your life? How has he changed you?
Well, I know I have found peace in my heart, knowing that I'm saved, that he died for my sins.
Yeah. Yeah, praise God. And now, you're here today, and why is it that you want to be baptized?
Well, I want to show my commitment of following my Lord and Savior for the rest of my life.
All right, praise God. I'm for that. So, Ethan, it's based on your profession of faith that I baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. All right, praise the Lord.
Amen. We get to be witnesses of life change through celebrating baptism. As we sing this next song, let's reflect on how we each have a gospel story, how each of us have been saved from our sins. Come on, we sing this.
How great the chasm that lay between us, how high the mountain that I could not climb. In desperation, I turned to heaven and spoke your name into the night. Then through the darkness, your loving kindness tore through the shadows of my soul. The work is finished, the end is risen. Oh, Jesus Christ, my living
has victory. And for those who have put their faith and trust in him, we are victorious too. Praise the Lord. Jesus Christ is our living hope. No matter what we're going through, we have hope in Jesus. Amen? Amen. Go ahead and take a seat, Harvest. My name is Ramirez. I serve as the pastor here at our Rolling Meadows campus. And it's so great to be in God's house with God's people on God's day, giving worship to him together in unity. Amen? Amen. If this is your first time joining us, I want to extend a very special welcome to you. And just know that you are amongst the welcoming people, and I'm one of them. So I'm going to be in the lobby after service in the welcome area. Please come and find me after service. I'd love to connect with you and just see how I can serve you during your time here at Harvest. Harvest, now, this is an opportunity. We're just united in worship. There's another way we can be in unity, and that is by pulling out our phones and checking in through the Harvest Bible Chapel app. So now we all get a chance to participate in this together. And Harvest, we not only want to know that you're here today, but we also like to know how we can help you, how we can serve you through prayer or helping you to find a place here at Harvest Bible Chapel. So do that for me, please. And while you're there, you'll notice something that we're doing next week. It's called Discover Harvest. And Discover Harvest is a gathering for those who have been here for a short period of time. Maybe it's today is your first day, or this is your second or third week. We want to meet you, and we want you to know our staff. And so next week, we're having Discover Harvest during the 11 o'clock service. It's only 30 minutes, so it's from 10:45 to 11:15. For more information on that, you can go to harvestbible.org to check in and register for that event. In our continuing effort to pray for like-minded churches, we're going to lift up City Line Bible Church again this week and our pastor, Mohan Zachariah. But before I do that, I want to read this over us this morning. It's in 1 Timothy chapter 6, verses 17 through 19, and it says this: "As for the rich in this present age, charge them not to be haughty, not to set their hopes on the uncertainty of riches, but on God, who richly provides for us everything to enjoy. They are to do good, to be rich in good works, to be generous and ready to share, thus storing up a treasure for themselves as a good foundation for the future, so that they may take a hold of that which is truly life." And Harvest, that is always our goal, is to have our heart centered on the right thing, not on our possessions, but on the Lord. The Bible says that God loves a cheerful giver, and God has entrusted us with the ability to get wealth. And so now we have an opportunity to give back a portion to him. And so if you take a look at the screen, you'll see the different ways that you have to give here at Harvest Bible Chapel. So join us as we continue on in ministry and reaching our nation for Jesus. And so will you join me as we pray for City Line, today's offering, and our services for today? Join me in that. Lord, we thank you for what you are doing at City Line Church. And Lord, we thank you for everything that you are still yet to do. And so God, will you just continue to provide all of the needs of their church? Will you bless Mohan as he delivers your message today? May it penetrate the hearts of your people. And Lord, we thank you for the ability to get wealth, and now we are giving a portion of that back to you. And Lord, it's our prayer that it will be pleasing in your sight. May it be used to take the gospel further than we could have ever imagined. And Lord, we thank you for this opportunity that we get to come together and open up your word and hear what you have for us. And so, God, will you open up hearts to receive the message that is coming forth this morning? May we be changed and encouraged through it. We thank you, and we ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, Harvest, before we open up our Bibles to 1 Peter, why don't you greet someone who you did not come to church with this morning?
Morning, Harvest. How are you today? Good, good. I love that video. It's like so peaceful. It just like makes me feel like I'm on vacation a little bit. You got those like birds singing and things like that. And I hope that you have planned your summer vacations. This is the time of year that I always get to and I'm like, oh no, I need to book something because it's going to be full soon. But you start thinking about taking some time off and taking some time for relaxation. And I don't know, if you're like me, I really enjoy traveling. I love new experiences. I love new places. I love trying new food in different places. And it's a whole lot of fun to be in new places and have new experiences far from home. But as I've gotten a little older, I like really miss being home when I'm gone. Like the first couple days, you really love your time there. But then I miss my family, or I miss my little fluffy dog, and I miss my house, and I miss my bed. I never had that when I was younger, but like as I've gotten older, like I feel like my bed just like calls to me. Like I'm in a different state even, and I can just hear it, Jeff, calling to me, because it's like that place of comfort. It's the place of belonging. It's like the place where I'm supposed to be is what it feels like. And when I'm away from home, I know that my bed, my home is there waiting for me, and it's the place that I belong. And we've been talking about 1 Peter. We're in this series that we just began last week. And we've been talking about the fact that we're strangers in a strange land, that we're in places, and God has placed you all different places. We're all missionaries for Him, but we're in a foreign land. This isn't truly our home. And oftentimes, the longer we're here, the more we long for our true home that's in heaven. We're going to be looking at that today in the book of 1 Peter. But before we do, let's take a moment and pray to the Lord. Father, we are grateful for this chance to look into your word. We are grateful for the fact that you have given us your word, your perfect words to us. We would pray that your Holy Spirit would be with us even now, illuminating the pages of your text and stirring our hearts and our affections towards Jesus Christ in a greater way as we think about all of the hope that's awaiting us for all of eternity. We pray that you would be with us today and use us for your purposes, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, if you don't have it already, grab your Bible, turn to 1 Peter. We're going to be in 1 Peter 3 through 12 today. Last week, we first began the book of 1 Peter. We really just looked at his introduction and the way that he's kind of introducing what he's going to get to. And we learned that you and I, if you've turned from your sins, if you've believed on Jesus Christ by faith, we've learned that you and I are elect exiles. That we were chosen by God before the foundation of the earth and placed in his salvation because of what he did, that he bought us, that he brought us to life and changed us because of Jesus Christ, and that we're also exiles. We're in a land far from our true home, the kingdom of heaven that awaits us. But while we're here on this earth, we're supposed to act as if we're citizens of heaven. And today, Peter, as he gets into sort of the bulk of his letter, he's talking about living hope. We just sang that song, and if you look at the heading in your Bible, mine says this as well, that we're born again to a living hope. He's telling us about hope, and we're going to see three things through Peter's text to us today. First, that our hope is secure. So we're to worship. Our hope outweighs any suffering that we could experience, so we should rejoice. And then our hope was promised, so let's remember. First, our hope is secure. Let's start reading 1 Peter 1, verse 3. Peter says, "Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. According to his great mercy, he's caused us to be born again," here it is, "to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, to an inheritance that is imperishable, undefiled, and unfading, kept in heaven for you, who by God's power are being guarded through faith for a salvation ready to be revealed in the last time. So here, as Peter gets into the bulk of his letter, just as he begins this, he starts by saying, blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. He begins with praise to God. He begins with worship. And why does he begin this way? What is our reason to worship? He says it's according to his great mercy, he's caused us to be born again, to have a new spiritual life that God has given to his people in Jesus Christ. As scripture would say that you and I are dead in our trespasses and sins. Apart from Jesus Christ, we are dead. And he has made us alive in Jesus Christ, given us new life, and given us here a living hope. Now, hope is a confident expectation of what is to come for us in Jesus Christ. It's a confident expectation of what is to come. It's not like we would use hope oftentimes, like, I really hope that the Blackhawks will be better next year than they are this year, because they are terrible. I mean, so bad. And I hope that, it's not like that at all. That's like, you know, that would be great if they are, but there's no expectation. There's no confidence that we have that they're going to be great. But that's not what biblical hope is. Hope is a confident expectation. It is a sure thing, but I'm waiting on it. It's a sure and sealed thing, a confident expectation of what is to come. But notice he calls it a living hope. A living hope, which is a really interesting way to say that. What does he mean by that? Why, how exactly is our hope living? Notice, what is it that brings about and seals our hope? Jesus's resurrection from the dead. Your hope is living because your Savior is living. Your hope is living because it is secure, because it's founded on the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Easter Sunday made a way for you to have hope, to have a confident expectation of what God is doing in your life now and what he will do in the future. We've been waiting and waiting for a hope, but we can have surety that it's there for us because Jesus Christ has been risen from the dead. He's alive, and therefore our hope, my hope, is a living hope. Second, our hope is living in that it's something that grows and grows throughout the life of a believer. Just as a plant or a tree is a living thing, and you would expect to see growth in that plant over its life, so too with the believer, the person who follows Jesus Christ, your hope should be increasing as you go about life. Sometimes in life, the things that we're waiting for, we allow our hope to diminish in those things. I've been waiting for so long. Is this ever going to happen? Proverbs 13:12 would say, hope deferred makes the heart sick. I've been unemployed for so long and waiting for a job and waiting and waiting, and I'm just starting to think, is it ever gonna happen? Or I've dealt with this illness for so long, and I've been to so many different doctors and have just not found the medication that really helps. Am I ever going to have relief from that? And that's what we experience a lot of times in life, that the longer and longer things take for them to come to fruition, our hope actually diminishes. But that's not what we're told that the believer is to be like as we hope and wait for our heaven that is coming to us. Paul would say in 2 Corinthians, he says, so we do not lose heart. We don't lose hope in these things. Though our outer self is wasting away, and as we get older, I think we all feel all of that, our inner self is being renewed
day by day, for this light momentary affliction is preparing for us an eternal weight of glory beyond all comparison, as we look not to the things that are seen, but to the things that are unseen. For the things that are seen are transient, but the things that are unseen are eternal. That's what our hope is in. And as we continue on in this life, as we wait and wait, as we're away from home, on vacation, doesn't feel like a vacation a lot of times, but we're away from home longer and longer, our hearts are drawn in deeper hope for all that's awaiting us. For those of us who've been following the Lord for a while, our hope in what is awaiting, it should be increasing. And the more we live in this strange land, the more we long for our true home. The more we're here, the more homesick we become. And as we long for our home, we can be sure that, notice what Peter says, that our inheritance is secure. It's just like a child who receives a wealthy inheritance from their family. And while they may be a kid, they don't have access to that. They're still waiting to receive it, but the kid's still loaded. The kid still has all of that. It belongs to them, even though they don't have access to it. That's what the imagery that Peter is using to us to talk about our eternal hope. His Jewish readers would have surely thought of the promised land, the land that was promised to the people of Israel, that no matter where they were, many, many years they were away from their promised land, but it was still theirs. God said it belongs to you forever. It's their inheritance. God promised to them through Abraham, and many times they were far away and weren't seeing their inheritance, but it was still theirs. And there came a day when God's people, they walked into the land and received their inheritance, and that hope that they had been waiting for so long came to fruition. And here Peter is saying that God's people, us, you and I, we have an eternal inheritance that's promised and sealed for us, just as the people of Israel had a physical inheritance in the land of Israel there. Heaven is yours because Jesus died and was raised again. And through faith in him, you're heirs. You have an inheritance that's secure, that's waiting for you no matter what happens in this life. It's been promised by God, and God always keeps his promises. Notice the security that we have. Peter tells us that our hope is secure. Look how he describes it here. He says it's imperishable. He says it's undefiled. He says that it's unfading and that it's kept for us. It won't ever die or spoil through all of the difficulties of this life. It won't ever be ruined by any failure that you could ever have. It won't ever fade or tarnish in any way by the actions of others against you. Nothing that you could do, nothing that could be done against you, no amount of time could ever make it anything other than kept for you. It's a completed past action. Jesus Christ has taken our hope, our eternal security. He's put it under lock and key in a lockbox, and he alone holds the key. It is sealed for you. And notice he says, who by God's power are being guarded. It's not just your inheritance that's kept for you while you're waiting. It's you are being kept for your inheritance as well. You're kept safe and you're carefully watched. You're held secure by a merciful and powerful God. And that is good news, that our hope is secure. Jesus would tell us in John 10, 27 and following, my sheep hear my voice and I know them and they follow me. I give them eternal life and they will never perish. And no one will snatch them out of my hand. My Father who's given them to me is greater than all, and no one is able to snatch them out of the Father's hand. Your hope that's awaiting you is completely secure. You are held secure by the Father's hands. No matter what this life throws at you, no matter how much time goes by, you are still held secure. That is the truth of God's word. So don't allow what you see in this world to make you forget that you are held secure. And so we should worship him. Nothing can take you out of the Father's hands. So we worship him because of it. We just sang, hallelujah, praise the one who set me free. Hallelujah, death has lost its grip on me. You have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name. Jesus Christ, my living hope. That's the secure hope that we have. And your hope will be revealed in the end because it is completely secure. So we worship the Lord because of the hope that we have, even as we wait in this strange land. And then Peter would say that our hope outweighs our suffering, so we're to rejoice. Our hope outweighs our suffering, rejoice. Let's continue reading 1 Peter 1, 6 and following. He says, in this you rejoice, though now for a little while, if necessary, you've been grieved by various trials, so that the tested genuineness of your faith, more precious than gold that perishes, though it is tested by fire, it may be found to result in praise and glory and honor at the revelation of Jesus Christ. And though you have not seen him, you love him. Though you do not now see him, you believe in him and rejoice with joy that is inexpressible and filled with glory, obtaining the outcome of your faith, the salvation of your souls. He tells us that our hope outweighs our suffering, so we're to rejoice. Notice, he says in this, it's not just the salvation, but the future hope and the inheritance that we have awaiting us. He calls us to rejoice. Again, it's not be happy. It's not sort of like pretend everything's fine, but it's rejoice. Have joy even though you're suffering. It's not pretend nothing bad ever happens, but understand that even in the midst of the heartache, we can still have joy. Because for the believer, our grief, your grief, my grief, the hardships that we have, they have a purpose. That God's using those things. And we may not always realize the specific thing that God's doing in our life. We may not even see it through our grief. But we can be sure that God is working, that he's using each one of those things, that the hope that we have, it outweighs any suffering that we could experience. And here he says that God has tested our faith by fire. Just as a precious metal is heated up and the dross comes out and it's skimmed off so the impurities are taken out, that a more pure and beautiful metal comes across. And isn't this true of us, that when things are difficult, that's sort of when all the garbage comes out? Like, I don't ever yell at my kids except when life is super stressful about things. And then I get angry. I have never in my life caught my belt loop on the door handle of my house except when I'm frustrated. Does that happen to anybody else? You're like frustrated, you're having a rough day, and you're like walking, you're like, that has never happened to me except when I'm angry about something else. Because when those difficult things happen, it's sort of like the impurities coming up. When there's a stressful conversation that I'm having with a loved one and in the midst of that conversation, the words are coming out of my mouth and I am realizing just how selfish of a person I am. Like, those things don't happen when everything's going great. They happen in the hardships. That God's using those uncomfortable things in my life, in your life, to grow us, to skim off all of that dross. A smooth sea never made a skilled sailor. And so God's using all of that mess, all of the frustration, even your belt loop caught when you're so frustrated. He's using all of it so that we would be more like Jesus, so that we would grow, because our hope outweighs our suffering in all of it. And he says, you're experiencing these trials. He says, now for a little while. And some of you are going through a trial right now. Some of you are experiencing suffering and heartache right now. And you read that and you're like, a little while? This is not a little while. I have been on my knees for months, for years, waiting for this trial to be over. This is not a little while. And if you're going through something difficult like that, an extended season of pain, of heartache, I just want to take a second and say, I'm so sorry for what you're experiencing. And I don't know why those things are happening, and I don't know when the little while is going to be over. I don't know the pain that you feel, the weight that you're carrying. It's a difficult reality, but every ounce of it is seen by God. Every ounce of it is known by a perfect heavenly Father. And I don't know what you're going through, but I do know the pain. I do know the heartache of being in a long trial and feeling like, is it ever going to be over? Are we ever going to see an end to this darkness? And Peter's point here is that compared to eternity, compared to the hope that's awaiting you and I, the trials and the sufferings that we experience are so short. They are so fleeting. And I know if you're in the middle of it right now, you're like, eh, it doesn't feel like a little while. I know, I understand. But in the grand scheme of eternity, the hope that's awaiting us, the sufferings that we go through, even a lifetime of suffering here on earth is just, it's but a vapor in the grand scheme of eternity. And so Peter is trying to get our eyes off of what we see and all of the heartache that we have right now, and getting us to see it's just happening for a little while, and it will be over soon, and you will be in heaven with Jesus for all of eternity, because life is short and the suffering that we experience is short, but eternity is long and it is secure for us. But notice, Peter doesn't say we're to rejoice when the trials are over. It's not to say that we've seen God answer our prayers, and we have. It's not to say I was in a dark season of suffering, of trial, and I leaned on the Lord and I trusted him and he brought me through and now I can rejoice. Now, all that is true. We should do all of that. Of course, we rejoice when God answers those prayers, and that may be the case for some of you right now, and I'm super happy for you. Praise the Lord for how he brought you through seasons of trials and sufferings. And the things that he taught you through all of that. But that's not what Peter is saying here. He's saying rejoice in the middle of the trial. Like, he's not saying once you dry the tears from your cheeks, then rejoice. He's saying while the tears are running down your face, still rejoice. And I gotta say, this was something that was hard for me to learn. Like, how do I rejoice while I'm lamenting? How do I rejoice in the middle of the pain? Like, while I'm still weeping, how can I rejoice? That was hard for me to learn, and I'm still figuring it out day by day, I think. But three things that I wrote down that have been super helpful for me. How do I rejoice in the trial? First, worship no matter what. Worshiping God no matter what. God, you are sovereign, you are in control, you are worthy, and I don't understand what's happening, but I'm going to worship you just the same. I don't see it, I don't understand it all, but I know that you're good, and I know that you're powerful, and I know that you're worthy of my worship, so I will take everything that I have, the good and the bad and the mess and the heartache and the happiness and all of it, and I will lay it at your feet as a perfect offering because you're worth all of it, Lord. So worship no matter what. No matter what I see, I will continue to worship the Lord. How do I rejoice in the trial? Worship no matter what. And then bring my trial to the Lord. So often we would go and try to fix things and try to, if I could talk to the right person, if I could bring your trial to the Lord. Worship him and then, God, I don't know what's happening with all of this. And I don't know how to fix it, but God, you alone can take care of this. God, please answer. So worship no matter what. Bring my trial before the Lord and then trust the Lord and believe that he's going to use it. God, I'm going to worship you. Please take this trial. It belongs to you. But I trust you no matter what. No matter what happens, no matter what the outcome is, if you take this away right now before I get off my knees, or if I never see it this side of eternity, I'm going to trust you through it. See, the answer to how do I rejoice in the trial, it won't ever be found in the trial. It won't be found in an answer to the trial or a conclusion to the trial. That's what we think. We think if we could just get past this, that would be the answer. That's not the answer to your trial. The joy, the rejoicing, it's not found in a solution to it. The true joy is only found in the one who's in control of my trial, who's in control of all of the suffering that we experience. We're to get our eyes on the Lord and off of my suffering, off of my trial as much as possible. Now, I'm not saying ignore the pain. I'm not saying stuff it down and pretend it's not there and just put on a happy face. I'm not saying shove it under the rug and just pretend it's not there. That's not at all what I'm saying at all. But sometimes constantly staring at the wound makes it hurt a lot more. It elevates the pain that we're experiencing, and it diminishes the hope that's awaiting us. It's like the child who is learning to skateboard, and they're trying to ollie on the skateboard, and they fall off, and they skin their knee. And every parent knows that silence. Like right when they fall, and you see them fall, and there's no noise yet coming from their mouth, and you're like, how bad is it? And they take that deep breath, and you're like, is it going to be okay, or are they going to scream? And I've learned as a parent, I have three now, so I've learned as a parent, don't go, because that's bad. They'll immediately start crying. Instead, you do the like, and there's just that moment where I've seen it go both ways. I've seen a kid be like, ooh. And I've seen time and time again where the kid will be like, ah! They didn't even react until they saw the wound. Until they started, look at the blood running down my leg. And so often it's like that with us. Like, we're in a trial, and our trials, I'm telling you, I wish they were as simple as a skinned knee. But we're in the trial, and we spend so much time, Lord, my knee. Lord, look at my knee. Lord, it's still bleeding. Lord, look at my knee. Lord, look at my knee. Wait. Get your eyes off of the pain. Again, I'm not saying pretend it's not there, but don't stare at it all day long. It will elevate the pain and the suffering that you have, and it will diminish the hope that's secure for you, because that hope far, far outweighs any trial that we could experience. The skint knee and the worst thing imaginable on this planet. Our hope outweighs all of it, but we spend too much time staring at the wound. So come to the Father with your skinned knee and fall into his arms and weep for the pain and the hurt that you're feeling, but trust that your Father's going to make it okay. Trust that it's what's waiting us in Jesus Christ is far greater than any pain, any suffering that we could ever experience in this world. You know, a lot of times I'm not staring at the skin knee, but a lot of times you're sort of going through life and you just like feel that stab of pain again. One thing that's been really helpful for me is going through like written prayers that different saints have written throughout the years. That's been super helpful for me. I've found in seasons of trial, lots of times I'm praying and praying and praying, and sometimes I'm just hurt at the moment and my heart is breaking, and sometimes I'm praying before the Lord and I'm like, I mean, I've said everything I can think to say. I don't know what else to say, you know? Maybe it's just me, but I feel that a lot of times. And one of the books that's been helpful for me, there's a series of books called Every Moment Holy that I have found very helpful. There's all sorts of things. There's like prayers for when you're making coffee. I mean, there's like all sorts, I'm not exaggerating, that's actually one of them. So there's all these like little prayers through there, but volume two of Every Moment Holy is all about grief and loss and hurt and heartache. And there's one that's, the title of the prayer is Upon Feeling a Stab of Grief, which is just like that a lot of times. You're like, I'm trusting the Lord for my skin knee, but then I'm kind of going along and just, it's really hard today. These things have been helpful to me, and this prayer was particularly helpful for me, so I'd love to share it. Upon feeling a stab of grief, the prayer says, let me learn pang by pang, O Lord, how these hurts, while they will never in this life completely cease, might serve like stitchings, binding me ever tighter to eternal hope. Lord, when it hurts the most, let that serve like a stitching, binding me to the hope that's awaiting me, drawing me closer to you. Don't allow the pain and the suffering that I experience and the grief that I'm feeling right now to be something that causes me to run from the Lord or to turn from that in grief and in heartache, but let it be something that binds my heart closer to the hope that you have. Allow the hurts, allow the grief to grow your hope in him, and trust that it's necessary for your growth. Notice Peter says that for a little while, if necessary, you've been grieved by these various trials. A passage that I've shared here before. It's one of my favorites is James 1. Count it all joy. Here again, rejoice when you meet trials of various kinds. Why? Why am I to rejoice? Because I know that the hope is greater. For you know that the testing of your faith produces steadfastness, and let steadfastness have its full effect that you may be perfect, complete, lacking in nothing. I know that's what you're doing in me, God, through the trial. James continues, blessed is the man who remains steadfast under the trial, for when he's stood the test, he will receive the crown of life. That's your hope that's waiting for you, which God has promised to those who love him. He's promised us these things. And so even in the midst of the pain and the suffering, God's purposes in my pain and my suffering, they may not be revealed this week. They may not be revealed this year. I may not ever know why God had me go through this, what God was actually trying to teach us. But someday, Jesus will return. And all things will be brought to life. And there will be that moment where we're like, oh, now I see. There will be a moment when things make sense, even when they may not ever make sense here in this life. And I think in a deep way, our trust in God becomes all the more precious when things don't make sense, when we don't see an answer to our questions, why? Here, Peter also points to, so what do I have exactly in the middle of it? I'm waiting for the hope that I know is secure, and I know it far outweighs any suffering that I have. And so I should rejoice, but what do I have here right now that can help me along those lines? Notice he tells us that we're to love him. Peter, in verse 6 here, he calls us to rejoice because of the future hope that we have, because of what's awaiting. But then here in verse 8, Peter's calling us to rejoice again. What does he say? Though you have not seen him, you love him. And though you do not now see him, you believe in him and rejoice with joy. He's calling us to rejoice in even greater ways. Why? Because we love Jesus. Allow your love for him, your intimacy with Jesus Christ, to be the thing that fuels your rejoicing. In Jesus, you have eternal life. You have that secure hope that's waiting for you. But in Jesus, you have abundant life. You have daily life walking with Jesus. And that's what Peter is talking about here, the joy of walking closely with our Savior every day. Because when you're in the middle of the trial, you need someone with you. You need a perfect Savior with you. Oftentimes when we're in the middle of the trial, we just want somebody to fix it, to make it go away. If I could just this. We often think, if I could just talk to the right person, or if I could just get some sound advice from a solid counselor, if I could just change some of the circumstances, if I could just sit down and talk with that person one-on-one, I think we would be, if I could just find the right book that was written that would give me some wisdom, if I could just maybe take a little time off, if I could just... We have all these if I could just things, and a lot of those things, most of them aren't wrong to do. And many of them would be really good for us to do in the midst of a trial, but none of those if I could just will actually produce what you or I really need in the middle of a trial, in the middle of that storm. We want the quick fix, that if I could just, a simple solution, and the fix is rarely ever quick, but the solution actually is quite simple, and Peter says it right here in verse 8. Though you have not seen him, you love him. And though you do not see him, you believe and rejoice. You and I need a greater love for Jesus Christ. Your affections need to be stirred for him in greater ways. And he's going to use those trials and those sufferings so that you love him more, so that you're drawn closer to him. You and I need a greater trust in Jesus and all of his plans. We need to rejoice in him and all of the things that he's doing in my life, even the hard things. There will be days when you want to just fix it right now, but believing and trusting in his plans means that you open your hands and release whatever happens to a loving and powerful Savior. Or there will be nights when you just want to scream, but loving him deeper in the middle of the trial might mean that you get out of bed and in the darkness drop to your knees and weep in prayer before a loving and powerful Savior. Because the love for him is what is most needed in this life. It's not a fix for it. It's not a, if I could just do this thing. The answer to our trial isn't found in the conclusion of it. It's found in the one who's walking through it with us. It's on your knees that you will learn to rejoice in the hope that we have in him alone. And finally, our hope was promised, so remember. Back to 1 Peter 1:10 and following. concerning this salvation, the hope that we have, the prophets who prophesied about the grace that was to be yours, they searched and inquired carefully, inquiring what person or time the Spirit of Christ in them was indicating when he predicted the sufferings of Christ and the subsequent glories. Notice they predicted the sufferings of Jesus and the glory of Jesus. It was revealed to them that they were serving not themselves, but you in the things that have now been announced to you. Through those who preached the good news to you by the Holy Spirit sent from heaven, things into which angels long to look. He's saying what we have now in Christ was promised to God's people from so long ago, and it is so much greater than what was prophesied, what was expected, what was looked for. Notice they were searching, they inquired carefully, they were inquiring, they were looking intently, sort of the like, is it coming? Is it coming? Because God's salvation, the hope that we have, was promised to God's people for generations. And through Abraham and through Isaac and Joseph and Esther and so many of God's saints were waiting for it and yet not seeing it. They were looking intently for the promised salvation. They had hope that it was coming, but they only knew glimpses of the glory that was to be in Jesus Christ as they were awaiting it eagerly. Jesus' suffering and his glory is prophesied all throughout the Old Testament, many, many places. Isaiah 53 is one that we go to often, that he was pierced for our transgressions, he was crushed for our iniquities, and with his wounds we were healed. You see, there's great suffering on the part of Jesus for us, and it's through that suffering that he and we experience glory. And that's just one passage. As we look through all of the Old Testament, all of those saints of Esther and Abraham and Joseph and Moses and Jonah and David and countless saints who God was writing a beautiful story of redemption, and they only saw part of it. They only saw glimpses of it, but we have the full revelation of Jesus Christ. You and I are recipients of that promise, that fulfillment of Jesus Christ, that our salvation, our hope is secure. And they didn't see all of that. They waited with hope, but we should look back to all of those things with joyful remembrance. To remember God's promises and remember what he's been doing and remember the things that he's doing even now. And it should cause our hope to be stirred up for what is to come as we wait patiently, as we're inquiring in the middle of our seasons of trial and storms, as we're waiting to see, God, what are you doing through this? What are you doing on this world where I'm an exile, I'm a stranger away from the hope that's awaiting? It should stir up and increase the hope that we have as we remember what God has done in the past. And not just what he's done in the past, but what he's done in my past. To rehearse and remember the things that God has done in my life time and time again, the faithfulness that he has shown us. Because so often we take the amazing things in our life for granted. We just overlook all of those things. And people in the past would have been blown away by even some of the things that you and I see like on a daily basis. One of the times that I was traveling, I was on an airplane and they came over the intercom and they said, you know, we're really sorry, we worked on it, but the Wi-Fi is down, we're not gonna have access to it. And there was like a collective, ugh, on this airplane of everyone when they found out the Wi-Fi is down. Now, forget the fact that you're in a tin can flying through, last time I checked, humans were not made to fly, flying through the air at 700 miles an hour, making a trip across the country that people hundreds of years ago would have been like, what? You can do what? You're flying through the air and we're complaining about the Wi-Fi not working for like a short little flight. Listen, don't allow the difficulties in life to overshadow the gratitude and the love that you have for God for the salvation that he's accomplished for you in Jesus Christ. You're flying through the air. Forget the stinking Wi-Fi. He's accomplished these things. And I know in the middle of it, Peter would say, it's just a little while. And we're like, it's not a little while, it's a long time. And he says, if necessary. And you're like, surely this can't be necessary. And Paul would say, it's a light momentary affliction. And we're like, what are you talking about? This is so hard. I know that the trials in this life are difficult, but when compared to the hope, the living hope that's awaiting us, it is nothing. It's just the Wi-Fi being down. That's all that it really is. Forget the fact that don't forget that the difficulties are happening, but don't focus on all of those difficulties. Focus on the hope that's awaiting us. And don't allow those difficulties to overshadow the gratitude, the love that we have. Because the things that we have now should drive us to gratitude. The things that you have, that they should stir your affections for God. When you look at the things that God has done in your life, they should stir up a greater love for him. Do they in your life? When you remember what God has done in your life in Jesus Christ, are you stirred up to love him in greater ways? Or are you just complaining that the Wi-Fi is down? When you look at what the Lord has done, does it cause you to love him more? When you remember the salvation that you received in Jesus Christ that was promised long ago to a people who never saw the beauty of it, do you love him more? When you remember where you were in your sin and brokenness and darkness before coming and believing in Jesus Christ, do you love him more because of that? When you remember the ways in which he's changed you and made you more like Jesus and transformed your life for good, do you love him more? Because the difference between cranky, entitled people and joyful, loving people, it's this right here. It's remembrance. It's remembering with gratitude what God has done. No matter what happens in this life, no matter what joys or what heartaches show up on my doorstep, I can worship because my hope is secure in Jesus Christ. My salvation is bought and sealed, and my inheritance is kept in heaven. As we go about as strangers in this weird, strange land, don't forget our home. Don't forget the secure living hope that we have. Remember what God has promised in the past and how he's brought those things about. And remember how God has promised you an eternal home. And it's secure. So let that remembrance add fuel and rejoicing to your worship. Let's pray. Father, we are grateful for all that you have done for us in the person of Jesus Christ, for what has been promised in centuries past, and how you have continued to work and work on our behalf, things that we couldn't even imagine you've accomplished for us in the person of Jesus Christ. God, we pray that you would stir up our hope in greater ways, that we would have a great confidence to see what you're doing now and to see it with eyes for eternity, that we would rejoice and worship you right now because of all that you're doing and all that you're yet to do for us in Jesus Christ, we pray in his name. Amen.
Amen. We have a chance to worship right now and to respond, so would you stand with us as we do that? Crucified all my sin and shame.
What a great reminder of what we have through Christ Jesus. Our hope is secured. Our hope outweighs our suffering. And our hope is promised. For those who have put their faith and trust in Jesus, we have access to all of that. So as we go through trials, let's remember that. God never promised that this walk would be easy, right? But he did promise to be there with us in it. So let's trust the Lord with all of our hearts and never lean to our own understanding of any matter. But what do? We acknowledge him in all of our ways through worship, no matter what we're going through, because he's in control. Amen? Amen. All right. It's so great to worship with you guys today. If this is your first time joining us, or if I have not met you, I'd love to meet you. I'll be in the welcome area in the lobby. But Harvest, as we go out on mission this week, man, with the living hope of Jesus Christ, remember that you are loved.